One does not know what one has until he has lost it, and never have those words been more true in my life than they were in the fall of 2001. I had fallen away from going to poetry night as I found much of the drama that went on with the participants and my ever-shrinking circle of friends had become the focus of the gathering. And while I still wanted to write and perform, I discovered that the drive to be creative had been replaced by a drive to be wanted, or to be famous, and to be loved. I had a couple of quick flings while spending my time at the coffee house, but nothing came of them, and I know that I was just trying to find something to get me through another day or another week if possible. I was still in contact with my ex as she had moved across town and then found a job back on my side of town, and as horrible as I was to her, she forgave me for how I made her feel, what I said, and what I did to her. Our relationship had gone from friendship to hatred and back to tentative friendship. She pursued her own life and I did the same in mine. Although I missed having her around and I missed having her to talk to and listen and help me through my frustration at being alive, I was glad that we were separated so that we could rediscover the care and concern we had for each other. I was still working two jobs, so my availability to fill the role of a shoulder to cry on for her, or for her to be my shoulder upon which to cry, was limited, and over a couple of months I started to see her pulling away and suspected she may be seeing someone and just didn't want to tell me. Now I'd like to take a quick moment here and explain something about my story. This goes all the way back to the beginning. I'm not proud of the actions of my past, and while it may appear that I'm telling my story to brag about how badass or super cool I am, I'm actually telling my story to show how fucked up I was, and that I know that now. While in the moment, our emotions can get the better of us almost every time, and when you don't know what positive application of your emotions looks like, or how to harness the negative emotions at least enough to keep you from acting without thinking, you can do amazingly stupid and harmful things. You may have noticed that I'm not justifying my actions, and I've even said in this series that I can only blame my upbringing so far before I have to admit and accept that I chose to continue along the harmful path upon which I had been placed. Now back to the story. Since my ex worked so close to where I lived, literally only blocks away, I started showing up in her parking lot just to see what she did when she got off of work. I wasn't always able to do this, but when I could, I saw that she was spending a fair amount of time after work talking to a certain other guy. Yes, I admit, I stalked her, eventually going so far as to follow her back to her apartment and sit for hours in a dark car waiting for the evidence that I needed to prove my suspicion that she was going ahead and living her life without consulting me. I don't remember exactly how long I dropped into the dark side before confronting her, but I'd say I spent a couple of weeks exhibiting this behavior and trying to justify it in my head as her lying to me as a friend. I wasn't willing or able to admit that the reason I was doing this was jealousy. Extreme and harmful jealousy. She was moving on with her life, and I was stuck with no one and nothing to move on to. How dare she not check in with me to be sure I was ready for her to live without me? I had learned of distrust and mistrust before meeting her, but jealousy was pretty much brand new to me. Watching the repeating patterns, I see that the reason I became jealous more than anything else was that I had turned my life into the relationship she and I had. I had pulled the whole guy meets girl, guy dumps friends, guy dumps girl, guy has no friends trick. In my loneliness and my self-loathing, I found one small flame still burning and I was suddenly enamored with her, and found that even through all of the hatred, all of the yelling, all of the arguments, and all of the disrespect, I loved her and wanted to be with her again and forever. I started with hints, and when the hints didn't work, I went all for it and told her that I wanted her back and wanted to get married. Her initial reaction was no. She told me that there was another guy that she liked and she wanted to see what would happen with that situation before she would ever entertain thoughts of me and her again. This of course caused me to drop into another round of severe depression, but strangely no suicidal thoughts this time. In fact, it would be nearly 10 years before I thought of suicide as a viable option again. Around Thanksgiving 2001, my parents were away from their house in Washington, D.C., and I asked them if I could borrow it for a few days. Still being held in limbo by my ex-girlfriend's insistence to seek options other than a life with me, I drove to DC and spent 2 days sitting in a small restaurant, writing in my journal and praying about what I should do in regards to this situation. Partway through the second day, I felt a peace come over me. I have since lost that journal, but I do remember 2/3 of the way down the right-hand page were the words, "Let go and love." Until recently, I thought that those 4 words came from God, and He was finally helping me figure out what I should do and how to move forward in regards to a relationship with her. As with all things from imaginary friends, the words I thought that I had received had to be interpreted. I look at those words now and realize that the key is letting go, not the love. But of course, I simply used it as justification to drive back to Oklahoma and push myself back into her life as much as I could. I started listening to her taste in music, started watching movies that she liked, and all the while I was claiming that I had changed, I was different, and that she was the most important thing in my life now and would be forever. Although I don't know all the details, she eventually called it quits with this other guy and we were back together. In January, after my brother-in-law and sister helped me to pay for her ring, I took her to a nice dinner and then to a walk through Woodward Park, got down on my knee, and asked my girlfriend to marry me. She said yes, I wiped the tears from my eyes, and we took off to plan the wedding and the life before us. Familiarity breeds contempt, they say, and after moving in with her and living with her for the first half of 2002, I came to realize that I wasn't with her for any of the right reasons, and I started questioning myself and my intentions, and looking back at the year before when I had dropped so low as to stalk her, and wondering just what the hell was wrong with me. The dynamic between her and I after our engagement wasn't what it was before, and I don't know why I thought it would be the same after all we had been through with each other and all the damage I had done to her and myself, but I found myself spending very little time with her, and eventually we started to talk about it. When I was trying to get her back, I told her that I was fine with her desire to move back to Ohio and live out our lives there. I thought I would be able to make that sacrifice if it meant I could be with her, but as the reality of what I agreed to do to get her to say yes to me sunk in, I came to the harsh realization that I had compromised my dreams and my desires and had betrayed myself and lied to her. I had allowed jealousy and anger at my past actions to get the better of me, and had determined to tell her anything she wanted to hear and nothing she didn't want to hear. Both fortunately and unfortunately, I finally couldn't lie anymore and told her that I still wanted to be with her and get married, but that I couldn't move back to Ohio because there was no life for me there, no future for me. It took a few days of conversation for the cold hard reality of what I was saying to sink in for both of us, but I remember the night we were lying in bed, both of us crying, both of us apologizing, and both of us watching as a future we had built up in our minds over the last few years generally, and the last 6 months specifically, crumbled to pieces, caught flame, and burned away. She handed me the ring back, told me that she loved me, and asked to be left alone. I went to the couch in the living room and cried over my lost future and my lost love, and over the next month or so, we found new apartments, and other than one night in early 2003, we never shared much of our lives with each other again, and she eventually moved back to Ohio to be close to family and now has a family of her own. I was on the verge of having another anger meltdown after all of this occurred, and in my frustration and need of change, I quit both of my jobs and took a new one so that I wouldn't have to be forced to see and experience the same memories I had with her in the places we made them. Shortly after breaking off the engagement, I started writing in my journals regularly. I don't talk about her in my journal for over a year after starting to write again because it still hurt to know that I had what I wanted, and since I lied to get it, it was worthless to me. Love is sacrifice, and either I wasn't in love as much as I thought, or I was still under the impression that she would do anything for me, including abandoning her family in Ohio and her quiet, idyllic life. Or maybe even perhaps both. Looking back from here, I see that the actions that I took, while some were deplorable, were beneficial to my future. As I move forward in time through my story, I'm finding that while I may have been a stubborn learner, I did learn. Some mistakes were repeated, some were repeated many times, but as I revisit these mistakes, I'm finding that the motivations behind the decisions were the problem more often than not, and that decisions made in haste were very often, if not always, corrected by level-headed thinking and analysis at a later time. Sure, I was young, frivolous, inept, and maybe a little broken, but maybe I was also just simply testing this thing that we call life. Trying on different hats or different wardrobes even in an attempt to find what would make me happy as I move forward in life is all just a part of being alive, and I thought I knew what I wanted out of that experience. On rare occasion, I still believe that I know what I want out of life, but I've buried it under a lot of dirt and disappointments and misguided motivations. When my mind can take something as freeing as let go and love, and turn it into forcing your will onto another person, there is clearly damage, and without my recognition of my flawed motivations and actions, I would have gone through with marrying my fiancé, and perhaps life would have been okay, would have been tolerable, but I don't think that it would have ever been enjoyable or fulfilling. I was finally starting to grow up and look out for my own self-interests without extreme selfishness taking over. But as with all things, I still had a long way to go.